The liquid hydrogen vent valve has been closed and flight pressurization is underway.
So you bought yourself a speed booster and can't get infinity focus? Don't worry, I've got you covered. Firstly, the brand of speed booster that you have will determine how you physically adjust its back focus, so make sure you consult the manufacturer's guide on how to do this. This video will be focusing on the Viltrox EF M2 Mark II for Canon EF to Micro Four Thirds lenses, coupled with a Micro Four Thirds camera. It's a cheap lens adapter, but regardless of whether you've paid a lot or a little for your speed booster, you should always check the critical focus of your lenses when adding another element of glass to your camera setup. Let's get right to it and get your speed booster set up so that you can not only achieve critical focus, but also infinity focus correctly on multiple lenses at the same time. Critical camera to subject focus measurements are essential for VFX shots and your focus pullers who may not have access to a monitor to see sharps and therefore will need to rely on the accuracy of the lens witness markings. To achieve a precision calibration, we will need to start by cleaning all of the contact surfaces because even a grain of crushed sand here will affect our ability to get a precise calibrated result. Once all your surfaces are clean, take your widest lens, camera body, and speed booster and check all the fastening points to the flanges are correctly tightened and not loose. Once you know all your flanges are tight and clean, you can now rule this out as the cause of your back focus or lack of infinity focus issues on your lens when attached to your speed booster. Attach your speed booster and widest lens set to its minimum focus on the camera body. Setting your widest lens to its minimum focus distance and widest aperture ensures that your first measurement is done with the highest margin for error. This is because our widest lens provides us with the shallowest depth of focus projected onto the focal plane inside the camera behind the lens where your camera's sensor is located. Now both depth of field and depth of focus are affected when the iris is opened up, but unlike depth of field, depth of focus is at its shallowest when using wide-angle lenses with the subject as close to camera as possible. An even simpler, more visual way to understand this is by inspecting the visible focus distance markings on a lens that highlight how depth of field is affected by camera to subject distance, regardless of the iris setting. You can see here the line spacings between the distance measurements become larger when a subject is closer to camera, thus harder to find and keep focus, then less critical, closer together witness markings when a subject is further away from the camera. So the wider the lens and the closer the subject, the more critical our back focus becomes in correlation to our lens witness markings. And this is why we need to use a wide angle lens to set up our speed booster. If you wish to understand this further, a great resource of information is a BSC depth of field chart like this one that clearly shows how depth of field is affected by subject to camera distance and the stop at which you're exposing. Plus, these are exceptionally handy tools for focus pullers. Next, identify the focal plane on your camera. It's commonly marked like this, so look for this symbol on your camera body. If you're using a Pocket 4K, this is not identified on the camera body. Blackmagic Design has stated the correct place to take the measurement is from here, which is 20mm back from the front of the lens mount. Measure from this marker out to your lens's minimum focus distance. Slide your focus chart out to this distance from your focal plane. If your focus chart is sharp, great, don't change anything. But if your focus chart is out of focus, you will need to make some changes to your speed booster's back focus. You should always remove the lens and the speed booster from your camera body before making any adjustments, as this will prevent any inadvertent damage to your sensor. No matter the lens you're using, always fasten the speed booster via the lens support. If you're not using a camera cage, use a more traditional lens support to take the weight away from the lens mount. This should also stop any lens wiggle that you're experiencing. Your first adjustment should be the biggest. Rotate the inner lens ring here all the way anti-clockwise and then reattach the lens and speed booster to the camera. In reality, the result now should be way worse than before, but at least you now know you only have to turn the inner lens clockwise to fix the issue. so there is light at the end of the tunnel. Repeat this process until you achieve critical focus at the minimum focus distance and when the lens's witness markings are aligned properly. Critical focus should be attained with 1/3 of acceptable focus in front of the subject and 2/3 behind the subject. You can see this simply by holding a tape measure on a slight angle, checking your depth of field chart, and doing some simple maths. If everything is correct, shift your focus to your next witness mark on your lens and check for critical focus. If your lens didn't line up, repeat the process until it does, and then check all the other markings out to infinity focus. If you're using zoom lenses, depending on whether it's parfocal or non-parfocal, you may need to compromise on the close end to get proper infinity focus. How much you wish to play with this and how exact you wish to get your lenses is really up to you, but every minute adjustment will make a difference. It will take time, but the results are worth it, especially for the money you save on this brand of speed booster compared to the much more expensive competition. Now that you have your lenses aligned, let's address another major concern with these cheaper, more budget-friendly speed boosters being edge sharpness. Considering we have now properly calibrated our lenses, let's see if this makes a difference to the overall sharpness of the image. The results speak for themselves. It's pretty evident what properly taking the time to calibrate your lenses with a speed booster will do. No speed booster will make your lens sharper at the edges. More often than not, the lack of edge sharpness is inherent in the lens you are using, and the speed booster is just magnifying the image and enlarging the lens, resolving problems. If your speed booster mount doesn't lock properly with some EF lenses, this is not exclusive to Viltrox. Here is a 5D Mark II with a native lens attached. No wiggle. Here is the same 5D Mark II with a Sigma lens attached. Lens wiggle. Even with no speed booster, the Sigma lens exhibits this well-known problem. This is because the EF mount was not designed to take a lot of weight. This is why heavier Canon lenses include lens supports, which eliminate the wiggle in the mount by removing the lens weight from the lens mount and camera body. If you want to limit this, a cheap fix is this small rig lens support. It costs 20 bucks and is adjustable to pretty much all lenses. Problem solved. As for speed boosters causing chromatic aberrations in vignetting, you have to remember, any piece of glass, no matter how expensive it is going to add negatives to the optical quality of a lens image, especially if you are enlarging the field of view and therefore utilizing the lesser technically perfect edges of that lens. This is the trade-off for getting a wider field of view. So you may need to consider that it's not your speed booster that is causing problems, and it might be the higher resolving power of the modern sensors that you are now using, which are just revealing the already existing problems with your actual lens. Canon EF lenses are known for chromatic aberrations, but this is something that is easily removable in post. If you have any further questions or you get stuck fine-tuning your speed booster, just hit me up in the comments below. That's it for now. I'll see you in the next one, dudes.